Good evening, everyone. I'm Hannah Renicki, and on behalf of the Colorado Chautauqua Association, the nonprofit steward of the Colorado Chautauqua National Historic Landmark, welcome to our community house built in 1918 and tonight's discussion. Before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to thank those of you who are Chautauqua members and donors. Your financial contributions help support our preservation efforts and make programming like tonight's event possible, so thank you very much. A few housekeeping notes. If you are looking for the restrooms, they are located on the ground floor of this building, so right through that door and down the stairs, and also water is available in the back of the room by the door you entered. So lastly, a special thanks to the Highland City Club for their partnership in helping put together this speaker series. We do have some upcoming events. Our summer concert series was just announced this week and features such artists as Ziggy Marley, Melissa Etheridge, and many more. And those flyers are available on your chairs and also at the door. Member presale for these shows begins Monday, April 18th at 10 a.m. You can find out more about tickets, lodging, dining, and ways in which you can support Chautauqua online at chautauqua.com. Thank you for your time, and now I'd like to introduce tonight's guests. Marta Kern is the founding director of Eco Arts Connections, which brings the arts together with science, social justice, and other fields to inspire sustainable living, with sustainability defined to include environmental, economic, social, cultural, and personal sustainability. Marta's awards include the Colorado Governor's Award for Excellence in the Arts, the First University of Colorado Creative Climate Communication Prize, and the Dairy Center Honors. She has been a speaker, panelist, and/or consultant for organizations in the U.S., Europe, Australia, Peru, Mexico, Cuba, and India. She has spoken at numerous national and international conferences about the benefits of arts, science, and sustainability collaborations. Jeff Keel is a senior scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in the Climate Change Research Section and also an adjunct professor at the University of California, Santa Cruz. He also holds two advanced degrees in psychology. He has published over 120 articles on topics including the climatic effects of greenhouse gases, stratospheric ozone depletion, and the effects of clouds on climate. He is the author of the new book, Facing Climate Change, An Integrated Path to the Future. He is a fellow of both the American Meteorological Society and the American Geophysical Union, AGU, and was the 2012 recipient of the AGU Climate Communication Prize. Jeff's current research is on Earth's deep past climates and what they can tell us about future climate change. Please join me in welcoming Marta Kern and Jeff Keel.
We didn't rehearse this part of the performance. We were going to do a rumba to start off, but decided to change a little bit. Okay, so Dance of Art and Science. I'm going to just start off. This is sort of our overview of how we're going to be proceeding. And so we each have about 15 minutes to do our little number by ourselves. And at the end, we'll have a Q&A for all of you guys, and then we'll be dancing together. That's the theory. And I have to start my little timer, my truth teller here. Okay. I always loved starting this kind of a conversation by pulling up this image. And when I think about the dance of art and science, I love remembering the very first images that are claimed by both art history books and science history books are these cave paintings. My connection to art, to science as a young person failed, to tell you. I didn't understand its beauty. I really didn't understand that as a scientist you could be outside in nature for the entire day and get paid for it. I was totally daunted by the numbers. It crippled me. I just couldn't do it. Instead, what I did is I was a dancer. I was a dance student, I was a dance teacher, I was a dance administrator, dance writer, and then I became a dance producer and started the Colorado Dance Festival with some really extraordinary other folks, our staff, and that was a month-long festival that brought performers and other dancers from around the country and sometimes the world to perform and teach for a month in Boulder. And one year, we embarked on this 3-year project called Dances of the Spirit, which explored the relationship between dance, spirituality, and the environment through 5 cultural lenses of folks who lived at the United States, in the United States. It was a very sort of primitive sorting that I had going in the beginning. But it was trying to think of, well, where did the folks come from and who were they now? Meaning the 5 groups were African, African-Americans, Asian, Asian-Americans, European, European-Americans, Latin American, Latinos, and Native Americans. And we had these little committees for each of those groupings and to try to explore that tripartite interrelationship. And we found that our folks, my folks, many of your folks, the white folks, the gringos and gringas, we did not have any more dances left that were done still from a traditional base in relationship to the natural world. They were all gone. At least the conscious ones were all gone. And when I say consciously conscious ones, I mean, oops, let me just go back here. Oh, there's one slide that's gone. Ah! The slide that was supposed to be there is the maypole dance. And the maypole dance, I always laugh about because it's usually it's little girls and they're in patent leather shoes and they're running around with, you know, the pole in the middle and the ribbons and all that kind of stuff. And I always think, well, you know, if the mothers of those little girls knew that actually it's a pagan ritual and it's a fertility rite and really what they're dancing around is an erect phallus, maybe they wouldn't be so happy to have those kids doing that particular dance at that moment. Meanwhile, doing the Dances of the Spirit research, I was wondering about the fact that at the time, you know, the fact that there were no more dances being done from this traditional vantage point in relationship to the natural world, that fact, and then the fact that at that time anyway, first the US, second Australia, third Canada, and fourth Europe were the worst polluters in the world, as well as those countries that in fact also followed westernized ways. I thought, well, is there any connection between that idea of having a personal, visceralized experience of the arts in relationship to nature and the fact that we were these horrible polluters? Was there any possibility that there was a connection there? These slides are really different, Jeff, from the ones that I sent in the order that I sent. Here's the maple dance. Good, you got it. Okay. So when trying to look up ideas or definitions of art and creativity. There are just so many definitions, it was impossible. And I thought, okay, well, I'll just choose a metaphor that I really love, that for me really embodies what creativity and the creative process really is, which is, faith is the bird that feels the light and sings while the dawn is still dark. I like this metaphor in particular because it helps me to feel what it is, rather than to analyze what it is. When Margaret Mead, the great anthropologist, first went to Bali, a story is told about her, which is she was so incredibly impressed by the exquisite beauty of everything that she saw, the clothing, the puppetry, the flowers, the food offerings at temples, the architecture and more. And she asked her guide, "It's so beautiful here. You must have incredible artists." And the guide said, "No, we just do everything the best that we can." The notion of creativity in the arts historically is a fairly recent phenomenon in the trajectory that is now called Western art. I'm not an arts historian, but these are some of the cliff notes that I found researching this talk. In Greek times, creativity was only used in relationship to poetry. Art in Greek, techne, was, quote, "the making of things according to rules," end quote. It contained no creativity whatsoever. The artist imitated, but the poet invented. With medieval Christianity, the Latin creatio came to designate God's act of creatio ex nihilo, which means creation from nothing. Creatio wasn't used to describe human activities at all. During the Renaissance in Europe from the 14th to the 17th centuries, an incredible flourishing of art and science came together in what we now describe as expressions of freedom and creativity. But at the time, still with the exception of poetry, it wasn't described as human creativity for over a century and a half. And even the idea of for that long period of time, human creativity was still met with resistance because of this notion that it was creatio ex nihilo, creation from nothing. Oops. But in the 19th century, the aesthetic movement arose and the belief in art and art's sake, which claimed that human creativity, some say, totally and only was in the realm of the arts. And by the turn of the 20th century, there began to be discussions as well of creativity in the sciences and in nature. And these days, there's a push to recognize the importance of creativity in all fields. You'll see Jeff's slides in a moment about science and creativity. Oops, in a minute. But there's lots of overlap between us. I thought it was great when I got his slides. But all of these notions of creativity, at least in the arts, have arisen from the mid-19th century, in part because of the aesthetic movement, whose credo was art for art's sake. Writers and poets such as Oscar Wilde and Théophile Gautier led the art for art's sake movement in England and France. And quoting the esteemed scholarly resource, peer-reviewed Wikipedia, art for art's sake has been defined as expressing a philosophy that the intrinsic value of art and the only true art is divorced from any didactic, moral, or utilitarian function, end quote. Now, historically, the primary function of didactic art was not to entertain at all, but rather to teach. Cultures all over the world have used fables and parables, myths and epic poetry to inspire people to consider the hero and the heroine's journey, to investigate moral choices and ways one might become a better human or not. However, in recent times, quoting Wikipedia again, the term didactic is used really as a criticism for work that, quote, appears to be overly burdened with instructive, factual, or otherwise educational information to the detriment or enjoyment of the reader, end quote. Gautier coined the term art for art's sake, and according to Lionel Lamborn in his book, The Aesthetic Movement, he, quote, denied that art could or should be in any way useful. He wrote in Mademoiselle de Maupin, quote, nothing is really beautiful unless it is useless. Everything useful is ugly, end quote. The poet Swinburne describes the battle cry of the followers of the aesthetic movement by saying, quote, art can never be a handmaiden of religion, an exponent of duty, a servant of fact, or a pioneer of morality, end quote. As a result of this movement and thinking, aesthetic value came to be emphasized over moral and social themes, and this in turn affected creativity and the arts. Our notions of creativity then became entangled with the ideas of independence, originality, innovation, and newness, and have followed then through abstraction in the arts and art movements such as abstract expressionism and among many, many other movements, and an ongoing questioning of what is art and what is not art. Now, science has, and correct me if I'm wrong later, Jeff, has a scientific method, which you'll hear about in just a minute. In contrast, partly because of the art for art's sake movement and the valuing of invention and originality, there is no one artistic method. Instead, there are hundreds of artistic methodologies. And there is a block in the thinking, I believe, among many artists, curators, producers, museum directors, and others, that art that is also useful cannot also be good and cannot be counted with the highest of high art. Jeff, take it away.
Thanks, Marta.
Sure, I'm going to stop you in there. Okay. So then just get that started.
Well, I thought I would start with a quote from a well-known psychologist. Creativity is bringing something new into being, Rollo May. As you'll hear in the second part of my talk, I sort of stand between the two worlds of the physical sciences and psychology, and the marriage of those two, at least within me, has been around climate science and how to better communicate climate science. I thought in the first part of my presentation, I would look at this issue of creativity. And I found this wonderful quote. A journalist once asked Picasso, what is creativity? And Picasso replied, I don't know, and if I did, I wouldn't tell you. And in a way, that's a good explanation of creativity or an opening for creativity, because I think we all have a sense of what it is, but when we are asked to define it in any substantive way, it becomes very slippery. And as you'll see, Marta has given you some ideas of how creativity enters through the arts, and I'm going to now give you a sense of how creativity arises within doing science. So this is my list that I put together independent of Marta's, and then when we compared our lists, you can see that there are many similarities, but there are also some differences. When you're doing science and you're trying to be creative, and you don't try to be creative, but when you're actually in that groove of feeling the creativity, it's often motivated by a desire to know, explore, and explain. And within the sciences, there's also this feeling of, and be the first to do so. In other words, that's issue of, you know, science, a lot of it is driven by curiosity, but it's also driven by being the first person to answer a question that nature has posed, or someone has posed about nature. So there is this issue or part of science which is very much around, I want to be the first person to find the new thing. There's also, and this gets to the practical side of science, there's a desire to answer specific questions. And for example, there was this challenge of determining longitude, which plagued the world in terms of knowing, they could figure out the latitude at which you were at on the planet, but you could not determine the longitude. And there was actually a prize offered in England, a monetary prize, to the first person who could find a way to determine longitude, especially longitude on a ship. This was the real task. A moving object like a ship, how would you build a technical device that could determine longitude? And someone actually did it and won the prize. So science can, in its creativity, can be driven by very practical questions. You know, what is the better way to build that mousetrap? Science is also grounded in basic laws. Scientists go to universities, they train in certain fields and gain a foundation in mathematics, they train in certain fields like physics and chemistry and biology. Those are the basic fields that are, you know, provide you with these laws that you then work from. Science begins with observing and ordering observations, and I'm going to talk more about this in the next slide. Science uses both reduction and synthesis. Often science has been criticized as being overly reductive. It takes things and dismantles them and looks at all the pieces, and the argument is that if you're studying something of high complexity, by doing that you've lost a sense of the whole and how that whole works. And yet, much of science is not just reduction, but it's also synthesis. It's bringing those pieces back together and seeing actually how the whole works. Creativity in science also requires tremendous patience in the holding of ambiguity. And this is one of the aspects that Marta had on her slide. Scientists often do not know how long it's going to take to find a solution to the problem that they're working on, or how long it's going to take to build that instrument that measures the thing that you want to measure. It can take weeks, it can take months, it can take years. And so that's something that's an integral part of doing science. And then the aspect of holding ambiguity, that not knowing whether the path that you're going down and pursuing is actually the best path to pursue. Sometimes you go down a path and you find that it's the wrong path and you have to backtrack and go down a completely different path. So that's where the patience and holding ambiguity come together. Of course, imagination and intuition are talked about much in papers written about scientific creativity. If you read essays by some of the greatest scientists, imagination is a word that you will always see embedded in those reflections. To be imaginative is to bring an image into one's mind and perhaps see the solution that you're seeking before you can actually write it down or build the thing that you are after. I have always been impressed. There is a tremendous amount of emphasis put on the scientific method. This is where you make observations, you propose a hypothesis, you test the hypothesis, and you either reject it or accept it. That's the scientific method that we all learn about in textbooks. Well, I think that's a great method. I personally have seen it work, and I've seen it work as many times as it not work. So I don't put a tremendous amount of stock in the textbook scientific method. Why? Because serendipity can play a huge role in making discoveries. If some of the greatest discoveries in science were made in a very serendipitous way, some of the greatest technologies, technological discoveries that we have been made in a very serendipitous way. So that means being open, being very open to the unknown and what can possibly happen within that space of the unknown. There also has to be a willingness to accept failure. Einstein said that being able and willing to error is an absolutely essential part of science. And we learn from the mistakes we make. I think sometimes there's a tremendous emphasis on, too much emphasis on success, especially with young children. I can't tell you how many young people I've worked with where they are unwilling to take the first step because they're afraid they're going to make a mistake. And making a mistake is a very important part of creativity. And then I actually put beauty and elegance, because you may not think of that in terms of science. You say, well, that's more of the arts. But actually, many scientists, some of the most well-known scientists, have argued that beauty and elegance are an integral part of creating a well-rounded understanding of nature. A particular physicist, Paul Dirac, who is one of the brightest minds in the developed quantum mechanics, went so far as to say, if one has a very elegant and beautiful theory and it doesn't match the observations, then there's probably something wrong with the observations. So this is my map or way that I see that science works and it's embedded in creativity. The four fundamental legs of science are observations, representing those observations in some way, being able to make a prediction. I think here is a big difference between the science and the arts. Science tries to develop a way of making predictions, and then validating or verifying those predictions. And then as a part of this, and essentially I put nature at the very center of this circle, because that's what scientists are trying to do. They're trying to understand and describe and predict nature, the natural world. So in terms of observations, you look for order and make sense of patterns in those observations. It's a very essential part of the very early stages of doing science. Once you've sorted and ordered and perhaps seen some patterns, then there's a temptation or a yearning or a curiosity about representing those patterns. And here we bring in the ideas, the intuition, the imagination to imagine, where are those patterns arising from? How are they actually existing in nature? If you're mathematically inclined, you can go beyond just ordering things, putting them in sort of a pictured order, to creating a mathematical representation of that pattern. Okay, that's what theorists do. Observationalists go out and measure things. Theorists sit down with those observations and look for the representation, the mathematical representation of that of those observations. And then if you have a mathematical representation, you can actually make a prediction. You can predict what would happen if. That's what science brings with it. And then you can perform an experiment to test that prediction. You can compare the results of the prediction with observations, and you can verify. If the representation, the prediction actually agrees with observations, then you have a sense that you've arrived at a deeper understanding of nature. If it fails, then you ask the question, is there something wrong with the observations, or is there something wrong with my representation, or is there something wrong with both? And often it can be both. And you go round, the reason I put the arrows here is that you go round and round this circle. And that's what science is, going round and round that circle, getting observations, coming up with representations, making predictions, testing them. If they fail, you go back to the drawing board, you try to imagine what's wrong, you try to obtain better observations that could put you on a more correct path, until you get that more accurate prediction. So science is also, applying that process, science refines our understanding of the seen world, of the felt world. And this is just a series of pictures of one such refinement, and this is understanding our solar system and the cosmos. You know, the original picture from Ptolemy was, and others, was the Earth was an immovable object at the center of the universe. And others, including Copernicus, came along and saw the problems with that. It just didn't fit the observations. That representation, that picture, did not fit all the observations. So Copernicus came up with a different representation. And he said, no, actually things work better if you put the sun at the center of the solar system and you have the planets going around the sun. Was that the final solution to the overall picture? Well, it wasn't. I mean, Galileo came along with observations that confirmed Copernicus's representation. Kepler then came along with an even better, more refined picture. He looked at the data and was able to say, you know, those orbits aren't circular. The Earth isn't perfectly circling the sun. It's actually an ellipse, okay? And if we assume it's an ellipse, we can fit the observations even better. And then Newton came along and he was actually able to show where Kepler's laws came from. He was going at a deeper representational level. He came up with the idea of gravity, that if you had a universal law of gravity, you could actually derive Kepler's mathematical representation. And, you know, most people stop there and think, well, that's it. Newton explained the cosmos. He explained, you know, the solar system. And, of course, he didn't. There were still some problems. When you looked at the orbit of Mercury around the sun, it didn't perfectly fit Newton's laws. And Einstein came along and was able to explain that last piece. And what his great leap of imagination was that space and time are enfolded, and matter affects space-time, and space-time then reacts and affects matter. Along with that, we had also the evolution of instruments to look at the world. I mean, look at the pictures of some of these early instruments. I feel these are works of art. I mean, the people that created these instruments did not need to put this amount of artistic detail into these instruments, and yet they did. By the way, the third picture, the one that looks like a clock, is the instrument, the chronometer, which is able to determine longitude. And of course, the bottom picture is the Hubble Space Telescope. And the Hubble Space Telescope gives us pictures like this. And I would like you to compare this with Jackson Pollock's picture that Marta showed. Which is science and which is art? I think at this point, I can't answer that. And just a couple last slides on science and prediction. Here are some observations. Why does a basketball go into the hoop in that sort of parabolic shape? Why does a fountain look that way? Well, you can take Newton's laws and actually calculate the mathematical representation of that observed phenomena, both the basketball and the water. You can even do one better. You can take that explanation that Einstein came up with, the space-time and gravity, and in 1918 he took that equation and predicted that space-time should have waves in it. There should be gravity waves. And lo and behold, just this last year, 98 years later, a phenomenal measurement was made. Two measurements simultaneously were made here in the United States showing, that's the figure at the very bottom, yes, indeed, gravity waves exist. And to me, that brings goosebumps to my skin. To imagine that someone can sit down and write an equation, the top left equation, and predict that waves should exist in the cosmos, and then almost 100 years later, ingenious people build instruments to measure those waves, shows you the ability of the human mind to delve creatively in the very fabric and structure of the cosmos. And that, to me, is the beauty and the art of science. And so with that, I will turn it over to Margaret.
Thanks. So back to my, let's see, I have to start this puppy up. Back to my Dances of the Spirit research that I was involved in. First, I want to get a disclosure here of the audience who's here. How many people are, and you can raise your hand many times. How many people are science people? How many people are arts people? How many people are engineers? None. Oh, one, thank God. How many are anthropologists? Okay, you others. How many people are other? Can you just shout out real quick what you do?
Jack of all trades.
Jack of all trades. Renaissance person. Anybody? I can't see you guys.
Technologist.
All right. All right. Anybody else? A different discipline?
Speech therapist.
Speech therapist. Cool. Videographers. You have other and frogs. So back to my Dances of the Spirit research. I'm reading a lot about climate change, right? And I'm trying to figure out, what can the role of the arts possibly be in the face of sea level rise and droughts and fires and more? And so, and I come across a study that basically asks what I call the big question, which is, why is it that so many people know we're facing multiple environmental crises, but so few people, relatively speaking, are really doing anything about them? This study observed that effective action arises primarily through a combination of cognition and affect, which for lay folk like me means your mind and your heart, your intellect and your emotions, working together, not separately. More and more research points to the importance of affect working together with cognition and suggests that what's called the information deficit model just didn't work. This is the model that says that if you just give people more information, better information, more current information, surely people will act logically. Now, this kind of goes and flies in the face of lots and lots of evidence that shows that logic is not enough, that human beings are not logical. Anybody that's tried to lose weight knows that just the facts about calorie and exercise don't necessarily always work. So one of the things that's really important is to be thinking about not only the cognitive side, but also the affective side in order to have more effect. And the reason, one of the reasons I ask why, what disciplines do you guys all come from, is these terms, cognition and affect, are defined differently in lots of different disciplines. But right here, I'm trying to kind of think about the cognitive realm is that realm that really includes what we call the mind, the intellect, facts, reasoning, analysis. And it's communicated primarily through text, graphs, charts, and numbers. And the affective realm includes the heart, emotions, feelings, values, attitudes, and beliefs. And it's communicated often through metaphors, storytelling, and images. And I think often, so the cognitive realm is the what, here's the evidence, this is what we've got. And the affective realm is the so what. What do we do with all this information as human beings in our daily lives? Many presentations of environmental information err on one side or the other. Either they're on the cognitive side of things, and so they say, we've got a problem, let's come up with a solution. There are hundreds of solutions, and often they just sit on shelves because there's not enough affect, there's not enough passion, there's not enough political will to actually put those solutions into practice. Sometimes the arguments err on the side of the affective side, so they go charging ahead with great passion, but without accurate science or other evidence, so their arguments are not as effective either, because anyone who's not already convinced of that argument can poke holes into it or ridicule it. Tree huggers, for example, perfect example of that. Another way to think about cognition and affect, or another take of it, is to think about the two information processing systems of the brain, and Jeff will talk about this much more knowledgeably in just a little bit. But I like to think about it, you know, that we all, for these different processing systems, we lean in our disciplines to one side or the other, depending on what careers we've chosen or what path we've chosen. And just to get through our day, every day, we have to use both sides of our brain, and we go back and forth. Now, a way to think about cognition and affect and the two processing systems of the brain and how to communicate things is in a couple of illustrations. So this is a cognitive way of communicating content to help people understand the concept of mass. And I understand from engineers that this is actually a very famous equation. I could not tell you really how it would really work. This other one is an artistic way, an affective way of communicating about mass, viscerally and personally. And this is Michael Heiser's art installation with a 340-ton boulder that's on top of a trench that you can walk underneath. Now, neither way of communicating mass is better than the other. They're just very, very different. Historically, the arts have a track record for living in the affective realm, for communicating through metaphors, images, and storytelling to inspire personal transformation and social change. And sciences, technology, engineering, and math, the STEM disciplines, live more comfortably in the cognitive realm, communicating through text, numbers, graphs, and equations. In the cognition plus affect equals effect equation, the affective power of the arts offers tremendous potential, as half of the equation, when joined with the other half of the equation, the cognitive power of science and other evidence-based disciplines through a creative dance. This is really important when trying to think about how to reach people in terms of climate change or other topics that they might not necessarily be interested in. And also thinking about before, about the dances of the spirit, the need for a personal, visceral, embodied connection to observable evidence. So historically speaking, here are a few examples of what I call arts power, and the power of the arts for being prime movers, for their affective power to move people emotionally and physically, to do things we folks might not necessarily have the interest, the energy, the courage, or the endurance to actually do. What we now call music, dance, visual art, and theater were all part once of what people just did, not only for entertainment and celebration, but to rev themselves up, to give themselves the motivation and the courage to survive and thrive. Religions across the world have used the arts to attract and maintain believers. Advertising has used the arts to persuade people, us, to buy things we don't necessarily want or even need. Entertainment education uses the arts to teach people of all ages, kids, as in Sesame Street, adults in health fields to address health and social issues and other things. Here are a few examples of how creativity in the arts have played a central role in shifting people's beliefs and behaviors in the United States when coupled with important issues that have significant evidence. The book The Jungle, written by Upton Sinclair, spurred the creation of the Pure Food and Drug Act of 1906, which later became the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration. It was the director of the Cuyahoga River Remedial Action Plan that told me this story, that it was two arts events that finally got the city of Cleveland to clean up the polluted Cuyahoga River and sparked the creation of the Clean Water Act. The first was a song written by Randy Newman called Burn On, Big River, Burn On that hit the top 40 charts. And the second was a theater skit on the TV show Laugh-In. Does anybody remember Laugh-In on television long ago? And Laugh-In gave the city of Cleveland, city fathers, an award for being so phenomenally stupid that they allowed their river to become so filthy that it spontaneously ignited and caught fire. As one politician reportedly said, quote, "I don't know about environmental cleanup, but we've got a serious marketing problem. We've got to get to work," end quote. It was an arts intervention by Betsy Damon and performers in Chengdu, China, that helped its citizens realize the state of their river and its pollution. Performers sat on rocks and dipped long pieces of white silk into the river. And they started out white, and each time they would dip and dip it into the water, the end of the scarf would become darker and darker and darker, and each time until it finally became black. And viscerally, personally, in an embodied way, the citizens of Chengdu were able to finally realize this river is extraordinarily polluted, and it in fact helped to convince the Chinese equivalent of the Army Corps of Engineers to put the meander belts back into the river that helped them to clean it naturally. Plays like Tony Kushner's Angels in America and choreography by Bill T. Jones, his piece Still Here, and many other theater, dance, film, and other works have helped Americans to shift their attitudes toward AIDS and sexual preference. This is a project that's in process right now that I'm really trying to keep my eye on, and it's an extraordinary project in Copenhagen. Copenhagen is pushing to become carbon neutral by 2025, including constructing the world's cleanest waste-to-energy power plant named Amagerbakke. And it includes art installations created by artists Bjørke Ingels and Jakob Lange, collaborating with engineers, scientists, and others. And the art installation is a steam ring generator on the smokestacks. Instead of pumping steam or smoke continuously into the atmosphere, it collects the smoke in rings, and releases it in rings. And one ring equals 1 ton of carbon released into the atmosphere. According to researcher Daniel Hackett, quote, "The purpose is to make visible the consequences of consumption. Anyone in Copenhagen will be able to see exactly how much carbon is released as the city's waste is processed into energy, even at the cleanest waste-to-energy facility in the world," end quote. Theater Grotesco's play, The Storm, inspired by climate change, describes, quote, "a journey into the social paradigms that prevent the world from taking action," end quote. Every show is followed by an audience discussion, and the audience discussion sometimes lasts longer than the show itself. And the artistic director, John Flax, told me that he and other cast members have been stopped in the streets by people who report their improved sustainability behaviors as a result of seeing the show. So partly as a result, and I'll flip through these really quickly, of this research that I did, and then work, trying to find a new role for the arts in climate change, along the way we founded EcoArts Connections, and it was myself, and also Linda Carbone and Karen Kelly, NCAR, UCAR. And EcoArts Connections, it was originally called EcoArts, and Karen brilliantly added Connections, which I thought was great. And we bring together science and arts and other fields to deepen understanding of climate change and sustainability. And we try to make sustainability personal and visceral and actional. Our activities include producing and presenting performances, exhibits, and projects of various kinds. And we've worked with, great honor to be working with, scientists, transportation specialists, city planners, birders, coal plant managers, vehicle emissions specialists, and other species of people, as we say. And as I come to this end of this part of the art, science, dance, I just wanted to quickly show you some examples of artists we've worked with to demonstrate this idea of making sustainability and climate change personal, visceral, and actionable. So as I hold up one of my props here, this is Chris Jordan, who likes to make the statistics of American consumerism visceral. And so this is a huge photograph that has bottles. And whenever you see it, it's like when you look up closer, you can see, I think, oh, there's my bottle. And I love this because it's how many bottles, 2 million plastic beverage bottles used and discarded in the United States every 15 minutes. And when we think of, oh, my little water bottle doesn't really matter, you can look again and see that you are part of a much larger group and that your bottle really does matter. And it's very inspiring to think of that, what you can do by yourself and others can as well. This is another photograph of Chris's, and this particular one is 30,000 reams of paper, which is the number that's used every 5 minutes in the United States. So do print on both sides if you possibly can. This is Mary Miss, an artist that we worked with who was based in New York, and we paired her with a hydrologist and a geomorphologist. And Mary knew that Boulder was one of the highest risk cities in the country in terms of flash floods. And with the scientists, they plotted the flood line of the predicted 500-year flood in Boulder. Some places it was 2 feet high, and other places it was 19 feet high. And this is in Boulder in 2007. 6 years, we're talking about predictability, 6 years before the flood of 2013, which of course, you know, we weren't intending to predict that flood, but we were just intending to give people awareness about it. This is Michelle Ellsworth, and evolutionary biologist Rob Guralnick collaborated on a piece called Preparation Y, or Prep Y, which is about the extinction of species, and it was a really loving and outrageously funny thought provocation of a world without men and what would be missed. And what not. Isaac Cordal is a Spanish artist, and he, along with other artists around the world, are increasingly creating public artworks designed to insert themselves into the attention of people numbed to the news of climate change information, or people who have decided that climate change is a hoax. These are barely 6-inch high figures that Cordell creates, photographs, and then hides in various places around given cities for people to come upon gently and by surprise, and to consider and reflect upon whether they would like to or not. And in an interview in China Dialogue, Cordell is quoted as saying, quote, "I think art can change things. It helps us understand the enigma that is the world and what we are doing here." Close to the very end here, metrics about the impact of art-science collaborations are sometimes very hard to find, but here are a couple of examples. And looking at ways that artists have transformed observable evidence and to have a greater impact through their artwork for regular humans. This is Kim Abele's work. Kim is an LA-based artist who invented the Presidential Commemoration Smog Plate series, where she made the images of all presidents, starting with McKinley Forward, out of smog. She cuts out a stencil, puts it on a ceramic plate, puts the plate in the smog, lets the particulates in the air collect on the plate, lifts up the stencil, and then there's an image. She has a wicked sense of humor, although she's a very compassionate human being. She leaves the plates out longer or shorter periods of time, depending on the president's environmental record. So you can see in an instant when you go into a museum who was good and who was not so good environmentally. The California Bureau of Automotive Repair commissioned Kim to help them in a smog awareness campaign. And Kim made these really wacky and sort of ugly sculptures out of recycled mufflers and catalytic converters, and then she put smog collector plates on top of them, and they put them all around town. In terms of metrics about its impact, according to the Bureau, media support for the campaign reached 30 million people and an estimated dollar amount of close to $3 million. It was considered the most effective media campaign in the history of the state at the time. The second example is Eve Mosier's work, and she works with scientists and others to show where the predicted sea level or storm surge lines will be in a given place. And then she and community members walk or paint and paint that line. The first one she did was in Manhattan, pre-Hurricane Sandy, drawing curiosity and community interest along the way. And she also did it in Miami as well. In terms of impact, Eve reported that Miami group members who drew the line reportedly went on to secure a planning grant from the Kresge Foundation for continuing to work with vulnerable communities around disaster preparedness and response. Next to the very last image, cognition and affect need each other, I believe. The arts with science and other disciplines offer us a way into climate change that helps deliver the information that engages both sides of the brain, that pops past politics, can reach deep into our hearts, can ignite the emotions to fuel the action that we so urgently need. In 1852, when Harriet Beecher Stowe wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin, it was a runaway bestseller, with only the Bible selling more copies at the time. And then it was made into plays performed all around the country. Lincoln called Stowe the little lady who started the Civil War, which of course she didn't really do. But what she did do as an artist was build on the work of abolitionists and others and captured the imagination of the American people to envision a world without slavery and how to get there. In closing, I'd just like to leave you with this mental image. The great Native American activist Winona LaDuke once said, "It's as if we're on a raft and we all know that we're drowning. If we could just see a new raft up ahead, even those of us who can't swim would dive into the water and make our way to that raft. Help me build that raft." The arts, with science and other disciplines, through creativity can help us imagine that raft and a way to get there, so we can get to it in time. Thanks.
Well, what I'd like to now end with is some reflections on, I've talked to you about the creativity in science and tried to communicate to you some of the exciting things about science. But one of the things that climate scientists were shocked to find out was when they started taking that science out to the public, they had a completely different reaction from the public in terms of communicating and their ability to communicate that science. There's a big difference between going out to the public and talking about gravity waves propagating through the cosmos and humans changing the climate system and leading to great disruption, both social, biological, ecological, to the environment that we live in. And that big difference, I think, is captured in this quote by Paul Slovic, who's a psychologist who spent his career working on the psychology of decision making. "Affect has rarely been recognized as an important component in human judgment and decision making." And this was certainly true within my scientific community. I mean, scientists are essentially trained to give talks to other scientists. And it's quite different when you go out to the public and especially talk about a subject that has tremendous affect, as Marta has pointed out, tremendous affect involved with it. So I was reflecting on, again, science and the issues of values. We now know that a person's value system plays a huge role in to the degree at which they can accept the science around climate change. But if you think about this historically, the appearance of new forms in both art and science have challenged our established value systems or worldviews. I think of, in terms of the arts, the Renaissance art, when you look at art from the Middle Ages, and you enter the Renaissance, one of the things that changed dramatically was the subjects that were painted or sculpted. You went from purely forms rooted in the Judeo-Christian story to Greek mythology, which must have been a tremendous shock to the value system of those hanging on to the Middle Ages. Impressionism, the appearance of atonality in music, all of these were challenges to the existing value systems. But the same thing occurred in the sciences. As I pointed out, the Copernican system was a tremendous challenge, not just to the science of the Ptolemy system, but the worldview that had been created around the Earth being in the center of the cosmos was challenged. Relativity created a tremendous challenge to the worldview at the turn of the 20th century, and quantum mechanics as well. But in fact, I would argue that we still haven't really grasped the challenge that quantum mechanics places on the worldview that we hold in terms of how we live in our everyday world. So reactions to these new forms that appear, be they artistic or scientific, are always accompanied with strong emotional reactions. You know, I'm sure those of you in the arts know the story of the first performance of Igor Stravinsky's Rite of Spring in Paris. A riot broke out over a piece of music. So there was an emotional, a very strong emotional reaction. Well, we're seeing the same sorts of strong emotional reactions around some science issues, climate change being one of them. So these new forms do lead to transformation, and they can lead to transformation not only in our values and worldviews, but also social structures. That's what makes them so threatening to certain groups. I wanted to show a little science to show you how things are changing. This is the change in the globally average surface temperature of the planet from 1880 to the late 1970s. And when you look at this, you see that perhaps from 1880 to 1930 or so, it was colder than the long-term average. And 1940 to the 1970s, the red line basically oscillates around zero, which is the long-term average. Why does this curve stop in the late 70s? Because in the late 70s is about the time that I started to work on climate change. And if you had asked anybody at that time, why are you working on a problem that, yes, there's change here, but there's no big trend in the temperature, the scientific prediction going back to the 1890s was that if you burn fossil fuels, you put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the planet should warm. And the scientists did not waver on that representation, that understanding of Earth. They held on to it from the 1890s up through the 70s. And just as I was getting my PhD in the remaining years since then, this is what's happened. We have continued to burn fossil fuels at an alarming rate. The increase of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is unprecedented in Earth's 4.5 billion year history. We've warmed the planet by 2 degrees Fahrenheit since the Industrial Revolution. We've cooked into the oceans another 1 degree Fahrenheit. And if we continue on this path, we're looking at warming, unprecedented warming. If we continue to burn fossil fuels at the current rate, in 80 years, the lifetime of a human being, in 80 years, atmospheric carbon dioxide will reach levels that existed 35 million years ago. And it took Earth 35 million years to get that carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and buried at the bottom of the oceans. This rate of increase is unprecedented in Earth's history. What comes with that increase in carbon dioxide? Increasing surface temperatures, a moister atmosphere, melting Arctic sea ice, melting of Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets, rising sea levels, reduction in snow cover, increase in extreme weather events, heat waves and storms, the shifts in the biosphere. All of these things we're already seeing. We know they're happening and we know why they're happening. The ocean acidification, of course, is occurring. And they're going to continue to happen as long as we stay the course in using fossil fuels. In terms of predictions, the black line, the solid black line here is that temperature curve that I just showed you. And the blue and gold shadings are the predictions that the climate models were making through the last few decades. So you can see that the models and the predictions, the observations, are fairly well on track with one another. We understand the climate system well enough to make solid predictions about globally what's going to happen. The planet is going to continue to warm. So the question is, if we understand this problem so well at this scale, why aren't we doing anything about it? Why are we doing so little? And I think one of the reasons from a psychological perspective is that this is a highly affect-laden issue. And whenever I go out to the public and give a talk on this, after presenting the scientific information, I always stop and I ask, how are you feeling? How are you feeling right now in this moment, given what you've just heard? Given what you've just heard from me about the rate that the planet's changing, what's changing, the implications for society, what are the emotions, what are the feelings that have come up with you in just in the last few minutes? I've done this enough and collected enough reactions from the public on this that here are some of the, not all of them, but many of them, people are fearful. They're numb. They feel a sense of tremendous sense of helplessness, hopelessness. They're angry. They feel powerless over what's going on. The older generation in particular carries tremendous guilt around this, because after all, it's the older generation that's been on this fossil fuel path for so long. And then there's always a few people who are defiant, that they really want to take this issue on and find solutions to it. I think it's important to point out that all of these reactions, and a number of others that I get from the audience when I talk to them, are all signatures of trauma. If you go to a textbook on trauma and you look up the affective signals or symptoms of trauma, there is fear, there is numbness, there's helplessness. I had one person when I was giving a talk, she said, "You know, it's interesting, about halfway into your stuff, I just checked out, I spaced out." Well, she dissociated. That was her way of dealing with the overwhelming traumatic information around climate change. So is it any reason, or is it difficult to understand why this has been so hard to convey to people? These are just a few quotes. One, Epstein is a psychologist at Yale. "There's no dearth of evidence in everyday life that people apprehend reality in two fundamentally different ways." These are the two ways that Marta was mentioning in her presentation. "The rational system," these are quotes from Paul Slovak and his group, "the rational system is a deliberative analytical system that functions by way of established rules of logic and evidence. The experiential system," which is the limbic, most of it is embedded in the limbic system that's colored here in this cartoon, "the experiential system encodes reality in images, metaphors, and narratives to which affective feelings have become attached." Now, this isn't any shocking new sort of piece of information. If you think about it, if we were just rational systems, then car manufacturers would present us with lists of technical specs for all the cars that we could buy. Is that how they advertise cars? Of course not. They're using image, metaphor, and narrative in very creative ways to effectively touch us through our affective part. And so an issue like climate change is not just affecting the rational system, it's tapping into and touching this experiential system, which is encoded in image, metaphor, and narrative. And here, I think, is the bridge. Of course, the word metaphor actually from the Greek means bridge, to bridge. The bridge here from the sciences to the arts around climate change is artists thrive and live in the world of images, metaphors, and narratives. That's why I think when you see the sorts of images that Marta was showing, it touches us, it touches our heart, it's touching that experiential part of our system in a very deep way. Of course, this has been known for a long time. This is a tapestry. Before we had all the different ways of explaining things to people, you know, in the Middle Ages, these were done through mosaics, tapestries. If you go to any great cathedral, all the stories are there in carvings and paintings. They were using image, metaphor, to create narratives for people who couldn't read. But the way they were reaching those people was very effective. This is from a quote from the theologian Thomas Berry, which I love. "It is all a question of story. We are in trouble just now because we do not have a good story. We are in between stories. The old story, the account of how we fit into it, is no longer effective. Yet we have not learned the new story." And that's really where we are in our social evolution. We have clinging on to one of the stories. The only source for our energy is fossil fuels. That's an old story. We have to create the new story in how we're going to create the flourishing society for all. And so that was really the basis of this book that has just come out, Facing Climate Change, An Integrated Path to the Future. There's no equations, no graphs, no plots, no tables of numbers in this book. This book is looking at this intersection between head and heart. And I try to argue in this book that it's time that we bring these two together around the issue of climate change. I'm going to just end by reading a couple quotes from it. Although we may be reluctant to face change, when we do, our lives become richer. On the social level, being open to change often ensures the security and health of a whole system, producing a better world for all. Transformation begins with the willingness to face the fear of change. The global challenges that face us today, such as poverty, energy, climate change, and social justice, can only be addressed through positive, creative change. If we choose to live according to stories of limitation, separation, and hopelessness, then we will reap the grim seeds of these beliefs. It is time to put these deleterious beliefs to rest. If we are to move toward a world of flourishing sustainability, we will need to create a new story. One of these paths to create the new story is to understand and become familiar with our feelings around change. We have a natural tendency to resist change, and there are good reasons for this resistance. However, we also need to learn to engage with the reality of change. Exclusive resistance to change does not prevent the inevitable. And let me just end with this quote, because Marta's in this quote. In my work on communicating the issue of climate change, I have come to value my interactions with artists. Given the power of imagery and story, is it at all surprising that the disciplines of arts are essential? During a discussion with an artist friend on the relationships between the sciences and the arts for a group of interested citizens, my friend and I realized the many ways these two fields complement each other. The sciences and arts dance well together. They provide a more holistic and creative way to look at the issue of climate change. Those listening to our conversation became very animated by the possibilities unleashed by this dance. Perhaps this is to be expected, given that artists thrive in the world of image, sound, body, and metaphor. It is truly heartening to see so many artists joining the journey of transformation. Imagine what this community will bring back from their hero's journey. And with that, I thank you.